Maybe tell me your name and a little bit about what you do in this room.
So my name is Naomi Saunders, and this is our SOAP lab. So we do environmental education here. So myself, Holly Bothwell, and Linda Rayburn are environmental educators.
Uh-huh.
And this is one of the classrooms that we use.
Uh-huh, okay. And you have them coming by the droves, I would imagine?
Absolutely.
What kind of grades do you have?
We do preschool programs, and we go up to grade 12.
Uh-huh.
So, and over here we have the pond, and you can see the trends, how it changes to the grades. So we have a pond for little kids where
I'm seeing a sink.
So you see where the little duck is pretending to eat duckweed over by the blue book?
Oh, yes, yes.
Yes.
Okay, let's go there then.
So, watch the cord.
Yeah, I got it. Uh-huh, so this is your duck pond.
So this would be something we could do with preschool, where we take the kids out and with their dip net, they can look for whirligigs and water striders and all sorts of things that live in the pond.
Ah, those little bugs that we used to do when we were children.
Exactly.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, and we still do.
I remember that.
And then we put them all in bowls. We call it the Tiffin Zoo. And then in all those bowls are the insects. We label them. And then we get into high school. And so we still do pond study, but we look at how much oxygen is in the water.
Ah.
And what's the temperature moving through the pond, and what kind of species are there. And we look at how those species can indicate the quality of the pond.
Right.
When we talk about how it moves down into our watershed.
That's right.
So as we go along, we're dissolved oxygen, we do a test for that, we do the temperature, and then they get to determine what makes a healthy pond and how we can test to see if it is or not.
And do you just work with ponds or rivers and lakes?
No, of course not. So here we have an example of what we might do with grade 4 curriculum, which is rocks and minerals.
Ah, yes. Uh-huh.
So students will come in here and they will classify a rock. They will identify different minerals. And then we talk about where we use them in daily life.
Ah, yes.
Where we have clay or where we have lipstick, which is made
So in other words, also the what they use in a quarry.
Yeah,
because
for sure.
This is such a big issue now.
Absolutely.
To can see.
Absolutely. And you can see with the beakers in the window.
Uh-huh.
Nice visual for students to understand that this is the world, and in the first measuring cup is all the water we have.
Uh-huh.
And salt water is comprised of...
Can you tell me why it's blue?
Well, to represent the water.
To what?
To represent the water in the world. So this is the ocean. So this is all the water we have.
Okay. So you put coloring in it or something.
Yeah, we bet.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. And so of the 1,000 milliliters, 970 is salt.
Uh-huh.
What is left of that is 30 milliliters, which is fresh water.
Uh-huh.
But of that...
In the ocean?
In the whole world.
Oh, in the whole world, right.
So this is the whole world.
Right, this is what Matt Barlow talks about all the time. So this is the whole world with the water.
1,000 milliliters.
Exactly.
Representing it.
And then salt water is that. That's, of course, why they're also taking the salt out of the water so that they can use it.
Sure.
And then you have
fresh
water.
30 milliliters.
So there's only a little bit, of course.
Yeah. And of the 30, 24 are frozen.
It's frozen enough in the Arctic?
Yep. All of our ice caps. Groundwater is comprised
frozen
of 6
water.
Milliliters.
Groundwater. Uh-huh.
And what we have in our freshwater systems that we use to drink.
Oh my goodness, look at this little thingy. I don't know if I can tell.
With the
sometimes going farther away is better. Yes, I can see it
now.
Do
you want me to put it in the light?
No, that's okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's what we have available.
Yeah.
And it's a nice visual because it's a wow factor and the students get
to
realize.
So this is the little bit of this is the little bit of what we have to take care of.
Yes.
And we're not doing a very good job of it, I can tell you.
Yeah. And that's why it's so educational, so visual.
Yeah.
It's just, it gets right to the point of what we're trying to do.
And of course, that's why the Naotifazara Valley Conservation Area Authority is so important to protect that little bit of water.
And it's the children who we want to learn.
Exactly.
The next generation. And not even just the next generation, because they go home at night and they talk to their parents about what they learned here.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's important to them, and what's important to the kids will be important to the parents.
Are the schools open to send you the students? Do they have a program?
There are. The Simcoe County District School Board funds school trips for grades 4 and grade 7. So they come out free. But we teach all grades, and so there are some trips that the students pay for, and there are some trips that are paid for through the county.
So in other words, the big expense is the school bus to get them here?
Yes. But we do outreach as well.
So you go to the classroom.
We'll go to them. To cut at that cost of the insurance and the busing and all that.
And, of course, you've got also microscopes.
Yes. So
where they can see life that isn't seen by the normal.
Absolutely. And we talk about, for this one, we do We do a soil program as well. And so students will take a big scoop of this soil with rock. And they'll put it in the top. And inside here are sifters. And they shake it through all the
Yes.
Right? And then they get to look at the different sizes. All the different grains.
Right, right.
And then here they can look at coarse sand, and then fine sand, and then silt, and look at the different sizes and how they're comparable. And of course also see the crystals and things that are in it.
Yes, yes.
It can complement the rocks and minerals program, but we can do them separately.
And you have a DVD for frogs and toads.
Yeah, so those are the scientists need help from the public, typically children, to listen, to be the ears all around, everywhere, listening to the frogs when they first start to call in the spring. Because we want to know what kind of frogs there are, where they are, and how prevalent they are.
Yeah.
And so that's a nice program. So the Adopt a Pond program sends them up to kids who sign up and adopt a pond and listen to their frogs.
What is the reason, I mean, for not having manicured lawns in front of the building?
Well, because diversity is definitely what you want to have in your backyard, in the forest, in the wetland.
So it's encouraged to have wildflowers and let grow what grows. I mean, a lot of people are worried about having animals when they don't have the grass cut short. Can you say something about that?
Well, what you have in your backyard is habitat. And whether you want it manicured for yourself just for you to look at, you're going to need some products to do that. So to make it look the way you want it to, you're going to need to add products, which are not necessarily good for the environment.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you're willing to let different types of wildflowers come in, I mean, the term weed is very subjective.
I know.
Right?
I mean,
what is
weed? I'm just going to go around so I can see it better.
So what is, weeds are a subjective term. What's pretty to some people
exactly
isn't necessarily to others. And so you have people pulling up things like swamp milkweed or the milkweed plant. Well, when we got rid of all of those,
well, we need those
rid of
for the butterflies, right? The monarch butterflies,
yeah. And now, fortunately, we realized, hey, we don't have any monarch butterflies. Let's let the
milkweed go.
Yeah, and now we've got the milkweed and we have lots.
Yeah, I've got some in my yard.
Absolutely. And
the pods are so beautiful when they open, yes.
And the pink flowers, and you see them on the road. It's in learning.
So what can we do to encourage people not to use pesticides and fungicides and God only knows what else? And I mean, I can see a lot of burned lawns in the summertime. Mine never burns.
Really?
Yeah, because I let it be long for starters. And I have a lot of plantain in it.
Yes, awesome. And in the quack grass or any of those, maybe not quack grass, I don't know about that, but to have different native grasses that are supposed to be fescue.
Yeah.
And like a lot of the grass seed in the stores is Kentucky bluegrass. Guess what? That's not native to here.
No,
so you're
going to
need to
go.
Add fertilizers and things to make sure that it does grow.
Oh, there we go. Yeah. So you have to have native grasses.
Having anything native, and native plants in general, because the birds and the bees and the hummingbirds that are native to our area are used to those plants.
I have hummingbirds.
Yes.
And I also have a lady slipper orchid in my ditch.
Nice. Now, those are rare.
I know.
Yeah.
I know. The first year I had 3, and this time I had 10.
Nice.
I mean, 10 blooms.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And next year
I photographed them, of course.
Yeah.
I think I'll put them in here, too.
Yeah, nice. We actually have some on some of our property as well.
Uh-huh.
I've not seen them yet, but one of our planning monuments.
Well, I guess I'll have to send you a picture.
Yeah, absolutely. I've seen them before, but just not on our property.
So tell me your name again.
Naomi Saunders.
Okay, and you work for the
Valley Conservation.
And you do that full time, and
when we have students here,
yeah,
there are months when it's slow, and that's when we try to promote more of the outreach,
right?
December,
to go in the winter time,
yeah. Although we do get some funding to have bus subsidy, so through some of our partners, they provide money so students can come here cheaper.
So we could also encourage the Rotary Club to sort of help for that.
Oh, for sure.
You know, something like that.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's them who started that.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
How wonderful.
Yeah.
How wonderful.
So they provided it for the first year and then the second year.
There you go.
That not only can kids get out here in the wintertime, and kids are nature deficit to begin with.
I know. They have phobias about it.
In the wintertime, when we have 33 kick sleds and we have 70 sets of snowshoes.
Wow.
It's a wonderful place to be in the wintertime.
Wow.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Maybe I'll have to bring my cross-country skis.
Absolutely. We have groomed trails.
I didn't know the place was here until about a month ago.
You've got to come in the wintertime. It's beautiful.
There we go.
Yeah.
So.
Actually, I'd love to show you the energy program as well.
Okay. Let's do that. Tell me about this next part.
So for grade 5 curriculum, there's a component that deals with energy. And we talk about renewable and non-renewable energy. And so you can see we talk about all the different types there are, and we have 5 different stations. So we talk about solar power. Here, students will use a light to operate these robots. With the solar panel. And then there's the fan that uses the solar panel with the light to make the fan go. And so this is hands-on.
So this is something that you can do at home. With the solar panels, you put them on your roof.
And part of that is that because solar power and renewable energy is so important, but it's just sort of a label that kids don't get to understand.
Yeah.
But when they do it here,
then they have a better idea.
Exactly. So the first station, we have a solar power, and then we talk about elastic energy. And so students get to take a hockey puck. And they get to propel it along a table and measure how far it can go using elastics.
To sort of give it a bit of a push.
And so as young scientists, they get to play with how many rubber bands, which the fat ones, the skinny ones, which ones send it further.
And the thing in the back measures it?
Yeah, well, this is we just measure how far it goes in terms of distance.
So do you always have it on this table, or do you have it somewhere
Absolutely
else?
Absolutely not. This is
you have
a
place
to show the members and anyone who wants to come and see.
Yeah.
Usually this is all around a room, and we have multiple, so everyone gets to try it, not just one.
Yeah.
We've got 4 of them. And then we have windmills, and we have fans, and which fans propel more energy towards these turbines. Would you use a condensed stream of
hair dryer,
or we have big fans, and then we use manometers and voltmeters to determine how much energy they're creating and which one does more. And then the next station is energy conservation, where students distinguish between renewable and non-renewable sources of energy.
Right. And of course, you have the oil there versus wind power or solar or something like that.
So we have all sorts of cards, and the students play memory, and there's a match for each one. So they're all face down, and they have to find both geothermal. And then we talk about is it renewable, is it non-renewable, and then it creates that kind of conversation where students educate each other, which makes it more tangible, because you can't always be learning from someone standing at the top in the front of the room.
Yeah, no, interaction is the best.
Yeah, so
when they find it out themselves, that's
absolutely
actually the best, yeah.
So it's a great vehicle for self-discovery and learning from each other when they get to play a game memory and they're learning about this kind of stuff that they've only heard about before.
Well.
And the next one is a wind turbine. So this gets connected with our faucet, and water is pumped through here, and again the voltmeter measures how much energy is being created by the use of water.
And the solar cooker? Wow.
So students get to make their own pizza box solar oven.
Take them
home. And so we have s'mores in there. So there's chocolate cookies with marshmallows, and we set that on. They make it themselves, and 20 minutes later we come back and have warm s'mores.
You have what?
S'mores. It's a treat they get to eat. So it's chocolate cookies, just like you would if you were camping.
Well, I don't know. I wouldn't suggest to eat them. Maybe just frame them and hang them on the wall or something, because they're not healthy to eat.
Again, it's all subjective.
There we go.
To some people who on McDonald's and
Of course.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and then if they eat McDonald's too often, they can't think anymore.
Absolutely.
So this is great.
Yeah, so they could learn.
I'm very, very glad that the Naotavasaga Valley Conservation Authority had to go in camera to talk about something. Otherwise, I wouldn't have come here.
Oh, that's good. We're glad you came.
Thank you very much for all your help.
You're welcome.
All right, thanks.